Greetings, and welcome to our first FUM lecture of the spring series. We are fortunate to have with us today Alex Perales, musician, documentarian, activist, and thinker, whose work I've long admired. Alex hails from the cradle of rock music that is Tijuana. Alex Perales started his career at 13 years old in the Cultural Center of Tijuana as part of a long-standing tradition of rock musicians from Tijuana. He has performed with artists like Julieta Venegas, Javier Batiz, Tijuana No, Mexican Jumping Frijoles, Pablo and Israel Varela, Gonzalo Farrugia, Felix and the Catz, and Ohtli, among many others, playing in concerts and festivals in Mexico, the United States, and Europe. In Europe, he performed in Brussels, Belgium, and Bosnia and Herzegovina, representing Mexico in the celebration of Hispanic Month in 2002 and 2003. In 2007, he produced in Mexico City a record for Ohtli Somos Uno, and the next year he founded the jazz funk fusion group called TJ Groove Station. In 2012, he directed Tijuana Suena, an organization to counteract violence by producing 20 festivals in 5 months. In 2013, he opened and directed the first school of contemporary popular music, the Tijuana Music School, in the northeast of Mexico at the Center of Musical Arts of Baja California. In 2016, he directed a documentary about the history of Mexican rock and continues to work on this developing project. One version of it, which you will see shortly, was produced as a short film in 2016 and premiered along with a concert featuring many of the bands and artists who were part of Avándaro. For those of you who may not know, Avándaro was a large music festival that took place in Mexico in 1971. It's often compared with Woodstock for its similar size, scope, and cultural significance. Perales has played in jazz festivals around Baja California, and he has directed the Tijuana Jazz Club since its inauguration in 2019. In Mexico City, where he currently resides, he promoted the project's Sonido Tijuana through internet events and an attempt to rescue the lost history of Mexican rock. In these projects, he reunites historic personalities such as Pajaro Alberto, Ricardo Ochoa, and Armando Nava, among others. Alex Perales performs in Mexico City as an artist with Peace and Love, Nahuatl, Pajaro Alberto, Javier Batiz, and his jazz projects and his original music. So with that introduction, I leave you now to Alex Perales.
We got the power. A border town lecture of utopia of music versus control and political power. First, I want to say that I'm very honored for this invitation that Professor Alex Khalil has given me and Cork University also. I'm very, very honored. Thanks very much for sharing this information with you. In this lecture, I'm going to talk about different topics that are related. Number one, history of music. Number two, political power and control. Number three, history of the Tijuana border town. Number four, the spiritual part of music. Number five, my personal story. Then you will see the relation between them. The main idea is to understand how through history around the world music and power relates, and expose the idea that there are only two kinds of music. One that is made to elevate the human spirit, to create harmony and heal human relations, and a second one that is made with the purpose of control and manipulation, and why it's so. This investigation I've been doing throughout my past 8 years of my 35 years of experience as a professional musician, music professor, and director of a music history documentary that is, in a way, it's been inspired by Jacques Attali's book, Noise, The Political Economy of Music. Based on this book, music begins in rituals by shamans with a purpose of healing, of harmony, of guidance of tribes, of guidance to a better life. And earliest civilizations used this technology of music in the same way. As channelizations of violence, symbolizing noise as violence and music as organized noise. This until the Roman Empire rises, starting a new way to use music as a scapegoat of political power, as a tool of control, a tool that throughout history will be very well used for political purposes. When the Roman Empire collapses, the clergy takes over power and controls music codes, and musicians' freedom is punished with torture and death. In a feudal society, musicians are servants with an employment contract that is part of a relationship of domestication without economic exchange, producing music according to the orders of the nobility who have the right of ownership over musicians and music. The characteristic of music in feudal society has the concept of natural harmony, which is applied by the controller. This idea places the rhythm and voice register as something that has the effect of soul castration of society to create the social order of the belief system. This distribution of music is usually only in the kingdom, place of worship, or concert hall of the nobility. As a political tool, harmony in music becomes the organizer of the noise violence, maintaining the social order, becoming a signal as well as the meaning of peace. Music as a reminder that musicians are slaves of nobles, gifts to controllers. Approaching the Industrial Revolution of the 18th century, musicians want artistic autonomy in their work. However, to do that, their work must depend on the monetary value of the parties who want to pay for the production of this work. Musicians come out from feudal environments to earn a living by playing in concert halls. This is the political form of the bourgeoisie, making themselves the members of the artists against the powers of feudalism, changing the system of production and distribution of music throughout economic ideology to artists as a weapon against the feudal society. The musicians before the Industrial Revolution are under the authority of the nobility, finally free, but still do not have autonomy over his work, depending on concert tickets, number of score copies which are produced in exchange for money, guiding music into monetary value, means money being the labor of composers and players. The middle class appears like composers, publishers, and tickets entrepreneurs to watch the show. Music is used as a tool to present ideology in the social order of society, that is, money as a representation of values. Music becomes a commodity, not only valued by natural harmony, but shaped by a controller throughout an aesthetic and theoretical basis. In the middle of the 19th century, new form of music is created. Powerful, soulful sounds emerge from slavery, escaping the tyranny of power, the blues, that in the future will transform to jazz and later to rock and roll, psychedelic rock, and many other styles. Finally, a free will of musicians searching for utopias, reclaiming the old shaman ways of the music. Also, in the middle of the 19th century, a geographical place is starting to give meaning to a future life, the California and Baja California border. As I call it, the last border in the world, not in a political way, but in a cultural way. The West conquered and colonized the world. As we all know, the Roman Empire disappeared and became, throughout centuries of war and conflicts, many empires, like the English, the German, the French, Spanish, and many more, colonizing Africa, Middle East, Asia, and Oceania, and the New World was left to conquer. The Spanish and the Portuguese came to Central and South America, while the English, French, along with the Irish immigrants, came from the North. And in 1948, after 4.5 centuries of colonization, wars, and legislations of the Americas, the West finally comes to its final meeting point, the promised land of California, where Latino colonizers and Anglo-Saxon colonizers collide and divided the land in two countries, Mexico and the United States. So the Tijuana-San Diego border history starts when the U.S. and Mexico War ended in 1848, and the United States gave birth to a brand new virgin promised land. In 1849, the gold fever started in California, and it didn't take long for the state to populate. So the preface of this geographical area became known as the Wild Wild West, no man's land, a land that started with no laws. The cities of San Francisco, Los Angeles, and San Diego quickly developed. By the beginning of the 20th century, movie-making pioneers found in California an ideal blend of mild climate, much sunshine, to establish what became the world's biggest influential industry of the world, Hollywood. The richness of California required a strong military, so they built the biggest military base at the time in San Diego. So now California had strong economy, strong development, and strong laws. And that's when no man's land moved south of the border to Tijuana, a place where what is forbidden or immoral is not forbidden or immoral, a place outside the law, the right place for an endless carnival. In 1919, the U.S. Congress ratified the 18th Amendment banning the manufacture, sale, and transport of alcoholic beverage until 1933. This course of action gave Tijuana the perfect starting point to become a very fast-growing city. Abelardo L. Rodriguez, a frustrated singer and ex-colonel of the Mexican Revolution, in 1923 became governor of Baja California. A few years later, he partnered with American businessmen and mobsters to inaugurate a dream resort complex in 1927, the legendary casino de Agua Caliente. As prohibitions against liquor, horse racing, gambling, and prostitution swept the United States, the vice industry flourished in and around Tijuana, to the extent that reformers came to call the town Satan's playground. Diplomats, royalty, film stars, sports celebrities, politicians, patricians, and nouveau-rich capitalists flocked to Agua Caliente's luxurious complex of casinos, hotels, cabarets, and sports extravagances, and to its world-renowned thoroughbred racetrack. Clark Gable, Jim Harlow, the Marx Brothers, Bing Crosby, Charlie Chaplin, Rita Hayworth, and the boxer Jack Dempsey were among the regular visitors. So were mobsters such as Al Capone and Bugsy Siegel, who later cited Agua Caliente as his inspiration for building the first such resort on what became the Las Vegas Strip. This era for Tijuana was great for economic and artistic development hidden from the laws of the Mexican government, vice and society at the jazz age. It became a place of attraction for Mexican adventurers, entrepreneurs, musicians, and entertainers, a similar phenomenon to the gold rush in the United States, creating rapid growth in the area that attracted people from around the world. An estimated of 30,000 people came across the border to Tijuana daily. And that is when the name of Tijuana, for the first time, became world famous. In 1935, the Agua Caliente Casino was closed by Mexican President Lázaro Cárdenas. But the debauchery carnival party atmosphere and mobster deals with power in Tijuana continued non-stop until today, hosting and creating artistic and social movements, as well as violence, prostitution, and crime. As they say in the Netflix series Narcos Mexico, what do you do when your drug protection decides to sit on the sidelines? Easy, you buy more. And everyone knows the best deals in Mexico are made in Tijuana. Call it Costco for corruption, where you buy in bulk. Why buy a few local cops when you can buy the whole goddamn force? Throughout the 20th century, Tijuana, as San Francisco and Los Angeles, mainly created the California culture that has Californicate the world, as in the lyrics of another TJ regular visitor from Los Angeles, Red Hot Chili Peppers, say, psychic spies from China try to steal your mind's elation, and little girls from Sweden dream of silver screen quotation. And if you want, this kind of dreams is Californication. Tijuana has been the Mexicanized part of Hollywood that you see in so many movies, as most artists, directors, and musicians from California have their own Tijuana carnival experience. Nowadays, Tijuana has become the busiest border in the world. At least 50 million people cross the border every year. It's a city of immigrants that creates a unique culture in constant change and evolution due to the constant adoption of traditions that welcomes from all over Mexico, Latin America, the United States, China, and from many countries around the world. Like most of the people of Tijuana, my parents are immigrants. My father was not a musician, but he had an acoustic guitar. He used to play just a few chords with his compadres on weekends, singing Mexican popular trio music. I realized I was a musician since I was 4 years old when I played my father's acoustic guitar. I used to just touch the strings and imagine colors coming out of the sound they produce. It became a regular game to play for me. And I must mention that since I was a little kid, teenager, and then young adult, I had out-of-body experiences that I could not explain until I read Hindu philosophy, experienced rituals with shamans, and practiced the teachings of Japanese Zen meditation master that helped me understand a little more the relation between shamans, music, and the spiritual part of being a musician. So I grew up as a customer of the California media. Since the transmission antennas are in Tijuana, due to avoid US regulations, I grew up listening to American music, TV shows, and news in the tension of Cold War. I was also fortunate, like all people of Tijuana, to be able to see in concert any of the musicians that the California music business had to offer in both sides of the border. At the age of 13, I started playing live with rock bands in the Tijuana Cultural Center. By the age of 18, I was already playing with many young popular bands in Tijuana. That's when it started to get interesting. A Tijuana music promoter took me to audition for Martin Mayo. He wanted to reunite his legendary rock band El Ritual. I had no idea who they were. Martin had a great personality and he really impressed me. He told me El Ritual was one of the most important rock bands in Mexico in the early 1970s. Years later, I read in the Latin America Rolling Stone magazine that they chose El Ritual only record as the best Hispanic rock record in the 60s-70s era. The other band members of El Ritual didn't want to reunite, so they didn't get together, but I became very close friends with Martin. He told me a little bit of his story and a very important history of musicians in Tijuana. When he was only 16 years old, he moved to San Francisco by himself to live the experience of counterculture and the summer of love of 1969. San Francisco became the cradle and world epicenter of the counterculture, with gatherings called happenings that gave strength to historic personalities like Timothy Leary, Ken Kesey, or Robert Gordon Wasson, that were promoters of psychedelic experience through entheogens, or so-called LSD or magic psychedelic plants. This is a similar practice as the ancient shamans did. Many important psychedelic rock bands came out all over California, like the Grateful Dead and the Jefferson Airplane from San Francisco, the Doors, Buffalo Springfield, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young from Los Angeles, Iron Butterfly from San Diego, and Tijuana was, of course, part of the whole deal. Carlos Santana moved from Tijuana to San Francisco to form the Santana Blues Band, and Fito de la Parra did the same to form Canet Heat. Both of them were protagonists of the Woodstock concert in 1969. Those days, Revolution Avenue and 9 consecutive blocks of bars and cantinas in Tijuana had 24/7 hours of live music. The continuous debauchery carnival party atmosphere that started in the 1920s with musicians like Jelly Roll Morton, who is considered the father of jazz, that worked from 1919 to 1921 in the Revolution Avenue cantinas and bars, and many others like Charles Mingus that created his Tijuana Moods album, were musicians that worked on the mystical street. By the 1960s, Tijuana had a strong tradition of music performing excellence, and Revolution Avenue was considered in all of Mexico as the music school university, influencing both sides of the border. Bands with musicians from different places, mostly from Mexico, formed in Tijuana and moved to Mexico City and became rock stars. Javier Batiz, who is Carlos Santana mentor and teacher, the Rocking Devils, the Tijuana Five, were among the first to immigrate to Mexico City in the early 60s. Then the Tijuana bands took the California counterculture psychedelic rock to Mexico City by the end of the 1960s with bands like Duke Dukes, Love Army, Peace and Love, and El Ritual. These bands led a musical movement in Mexico City that spread throughout the country. Mexico, like most Latin American countries, suffered the consequences of violent Cold War by means of U.S. imperialism that prohibited artistic and ideological liberal movements during the decades of the 60s and 70s. In Mexico City, from 1968 to 1971, about 2,000 people, mostly students, disappeared, most of them killed in two massacres: the Tlatelolco protest in October of 1968 and El Halconazo in June of 1971. And 3 months after the killing of El Halconazo, in September of 1971, in the nearby woods, 90 miles from Mexico City, Mexico had its own Woodstock, the biggest and most controversial rock concert in Mexico's history. The concert of Avándaro, 3 days of live music performance. At least 300,000 young people showed up in a massive gathering supporting a musical and cultural demonstration that asks for love, peace, and a better understanding of humanity. Bands from all over Mexico play original songs only. No covers were played. The promotion started to get viral by word of mouth, then in radio and even television. Everyone started to talk about the concert. And when finally the day came, the concert was broadcast live. Nobody imagined that that many people would show up, especially the government. Soldiers were in charge of security. Many testimonials say that they were selling marijuana to the crowds. There were many technical difficulties. After an outstanding performance of El Ritual came the most mythical and iconic moment when the band Peace and Love sang their song, We Got the Power. These are the lyrics. When we are on the stage and making music, there are some things that you can't take away. Cause it's our feeling, our own creation, something groovy to play together. That's what I say, yeah. We got the power. We got the power. You got the power. It's in yourself. Any way you can feel it, communicate. With our music, we feel the power. And we want all of you to feel the same. And that's what I said. Then suddenly, with the military helicopter on top of them and surrounded by soldiers, the crowds of 300,000 people started chanting, Tenemos el poder, which is the Spanish translation for We Got the Power. Tenemos el poder, tenemos el poder, tenemos el poder. The live radio signal that was broadcasting live got cut off. And the very next day, Mexican government, with his own loyal, almighty, powerful Mexican media, went against Mexican rock. Newspapers, radio, and television spoke horrors against the Mexican rock movement. Rock concerts and gigs were banned. Even people were taken to jail for having long hair, wearing jeans, and carrying rock music albums. The radio and television started promoting pre-made, overproduced entertainers singing harmless songs, mainly with lyrics about suffering for love. Music as the scapegoat of political power. Producing music according to the orders of the Mexican media, who have the right of ownership over musicians and music. Soul castration of society to create the social order of the belief system. The concept of natural harmony, which is applied by the controller. In other words, Mexico went back to feudalism. For about 15 years, rock concerts were prohibited in Mexico City. Tijuana musicians went back and played in hotels and casinos in San Diego and the California area or Las Vegas, while the Mexican media banished this story from public opinion. When I was about 23 years old, in the middle of the 90s, I came to play to Mexico City for the first time. I felt overwhelmed by how they welcomed musicians from Tijuana. Everybody started to ask me about the musicians from Tijuana. I didn't know much at the moment, but now I do. That opened many doors to me as a musician. Then many years passed, and I felt very strongly that someone had to tell that story. So I started to look for movie makers and writers, but they didn't have the experience like I did as a musician. So here I am, telling the story. On September 11 of this year will be the 50th anniversary of Avándaro concert. We are trying the best to tell this story to younger generations that seem every day more and more captured by electronic devices stealing minds' elation. The engineering of mass manipulation continues to evolve. The concept of natural harmony, which is applied by the controller, continues. So I ask the question, will music do its part again? It's up to us, and mainly to younger generations, to decide. I will end this lecture by quoting a paragraph from the Jacques Attali book Noise that is actually an extract from the book The Teachings of Don Juan by Carlos Castaneda. When a man starts to learn, he is never clear about his objectives. His purpose is faulty. His intent is vague. He hopes for rewards that will never materialize, for he knows nothing of the hardships of learning. He slowly begins to learn bit by bit at first, then in big chunks, and his thoughts soon clash. What he learns is never what he pictured or imagined, and so he begins to be afraid. Learning is never what one expects. Every step of learning is a new task, and the fear the man is experiencing begins to mount mercilessly and unyieldingly. This is the time when a man has no more fears, no more impatient clarity of mind, a time when all his power is in check. If a man lives his faith true, he can then be called a man of knowledge. If only for the brief moment when he succeeds in fighting off his last invincible enemy. That moment of clarity, power, and knowledge is enough. Don Juan's Knowledge by Peyote is reminiscent of the prophetic knowledge of the shaman, of the ritual function of the pharmacon, and of the interference between stages in the deployment of systems of music. Music, like intelligence, is intuition, a path to knowledge. A path? No. A battlefield. Thank you very much.
El ser humano, antes de ver, escucha. Está construido por vibraciones sonoras, creando fenómenos de movimiento, emoción, vida, humanidad. La humanidad se multiplica, crea civilizaciones poderosas, desarrolla sistemas de control político y económico, creando fronteras físicas, mentales y espirituales, que serán derribadas contando miles de historias a lo largo de la humanidad. Hay una historia de frontera, de vibraciones sonoras que jamás ha sido contada, la historia del fenómeno del sonido Tijuana. A principios de los años 60, Tijuana, por su situación geográfica e histórica, crea en la Avenida Revolución un singular movimiento de agrupaciones y músicos. Molora, Peace and Love, Tuk Tuks, El Ritual, Pájaro Albert, Carlos Santana y Javier Batiz, entre otros.
Musicalmente hablando, ya se le llamaba la Catedral del Rock.
Todos los músicos que tocaban en la Revolución, todos eran buenos.
Cuando empezó el rock en Estados Unidos, inmediatamente pasó a la frontera.
Salió de Tijuana nuestro baluarte mexicano, Carlos Santana.
Tu tiempo en Tijuana, teníamos la Revolución. Había burros rayados, pachucos estampados, gringos que venían de a montón.
De las 7 de la mañana nos quedábamos hasta como 2, 3, 4 de la tarde practicando todos los días. Tocábamos como 16 horas diarias.
Así que estaba pero grueso, amigo. Gente todo el día. Había gente tomando already cuando estábamos ensayando.
Gente, los gabachos de Los Ángeles, por ejemplo, están a 2-3 horas de Tijuana. Y los de San Diego y todos bajaban a Tijuana a vivir el rock and roll.
No, sí, miraban varios miles. Y no nomás los viernes, sábados, lunes, martes, miércoles, domingo, martes, miércoles, jueves, todos los días.
Y las bandas, como tocaban 5 tandas diarias, 6 días a la semana, y a veces turno quebrado, que venía siendo 7 tandas, ¿no? Todos los días, pues te haces bueno.
Estos músicos se miran para el norte y el sur, causando un gran impacto. En la Ciudad de México, encabezaron una revolución del rock que se extendió por todo el país.
Siempre para nosotros, las bandas de Tijuana, pues siempre eran como nuestros maestros, que nosotros, siendo chilangos, pues estábamos más lejos de donde venían la música.
Era muy reconocible, por ejemplo, que los grupos más, indiscutiblemente, los más populares eran los grupos que veníamos de Tijuana, indiscutiblemente.
Y estos llegaron con una onda mucho más gruesa que todo lo que estábamos tocando allá en México.
Desde Batiz te llegó. Ni Batiz pues les voló el coco porque llevaba el sonido Tijuana.
Imagínate, la gente nunca ha oído ese tipo de música, olvídate.
Y la impresión que los chilangos tenían de Tijuana era como una especie de Liverpool a la Mexica.
Es una cosa increíble, o sea que tú te das cuenta que te están poniendo atención 100%.
La mamá de Carlos le fue a pedir a Javier que le diera clases de guitarra a Carlos Santana. Y más que su maestro, él fue el que le pasó el secreto del rock para engrandecer su arte y llegar a ser lo que es, una superestrella.
Carlos y yo fuimos al concierto y por Carlos vio a Javier y pues, le voló la mente.
I went to a park in Tijuana and there was a live band. What it did to me, it was indescribable. I felt like this is it for the rest of my life, like this is it, you know. And hearing the impact of electric guitar, I mean, I've seen guitar before on TV, doing Eddie and, you know, Elvis Presley and people like that, but it didn't do anything, you know, not until I saw this guy. He's still alive, his name is Javier Batiz.
Definitivamente cuando llegó el maestro Javier Batiz aquí a empezar a rock and rollear en la onda del blues y del rock más pesado, pues aquí estábamos en otra onda.
Canciones pues muy fresitas y sin nada de funk, ¿no? Y eso fue lo que cambié yo, llegué y ¡au! ¿No?
Era la onda psicodélica, ¿no? La onda ácida también, ¿no?
Los códigos musicales traen consigo ideas de libertad que cuestionan el poder político.
Durante el orco nos encontró ya tocando en el Distrito Federal.
Una vez yo venía de la Villa Olímpica, venía caminando y estaba la ciudad universitaria. Y doy vuelta a la. Yo quise cruzar por la ciudad universitaria y que resulta que había tanques de guerra apuntándome a mí.
Acaban de golpear a miles de estudiantes. Los metieron a la cárcel, otros los mataron.
El sistema, pues no quería que que digamos que la gente se sublevara. Tan es así que ahora sé que, por ejemplo, en México había espías por todos lados, ¿no?
El movimiento llega a su cúspide el 11 de septiembre de 1971.
Abanda. Puro amor. O sea, completamente la gente estaba enamorada de la música y estuvo ahí para escuchar música, para pasársela bien, para hacer hermandad. Y eso fue lo que fue Abanda. Abanda fue un milagro.
Al haber unión, quiere decir que había poder, que había fuerza, que había todo. Entonces, we got the power.
Digamos el poder musical sobre la gente.
El poder político mexicano, al igual que en el resto de América Latina, bajo la presión de la Guerra Fría, sabotea y tergiversa la naturaleza armonizadora de la música por medio de sus poderosos tentáculos mediáticos, disolviendo esta historia en el tiempo.
Abándalo fue, digamos, la gota que derramó el vaso.
Se sintió que ya no querían dar de plan, ya no querían dar ningún permiso para hacer algún concierto. Y de eso vivíamos nosotros.
Prohíben el rock and roll y todos estos talentos tienen que abandonar el bajo.
¡Prohibido! ¿Cómo se atreven a prohibir una forma musical?
Íbamos a ir a tocar y pum, llegaba el latín y te cerraba todo. O llegaba el ejército y te corría a todos los chavos.
Estos legendarios músicos cuentan su historia, dejando el mensaje final de su legado, que fue interrumpido 40 años atrás.
Oye, ¿dónde están los 200.000 cabrones que estuvieron en la banda?
Y no vamos a parar. Más fuerte vamos a cantar. Más fuerte. Tienen que oír lo que tenemos que decir.
Evolución.